Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. President, today I've heard the words moral imperative. I heard faith and philosophy. I heard the Sermon on the Mount more than once. I heard the Good Samaritan. I heard faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is charity. I heard, suffer the little children to come unto me. I heard, father's sins upon the children, suffer it not to be so. I kind of paraphrased that one. And I heard, ashamed. I feel like I'm in church. Mr. President, the longest time I hear these words, moral imperative. Let's clarify. What is the moral imperative here? We're going to go here. Because many people haphazardly use what I hold as holy. Maybe you don't. Maybe you think I'm a fool for holding it holy. But you're quoting the Bible. Do you want to hear the Sermon on the Mount? I'm here. I have it right here. I knew this was going to happen. The Sermon on the Mount really talks about personal responsibility on many levels. It pricks the conscience so much that one can't read it without feeling an obligation of crying out for mercy to a holy God. The Sermon on the Mount. We can go there. I can quote every verse of that book. I heard 1 Corinthians chapter 13. In the original language, it was agape, charity. Let me start off with the first verse. Though I speak with tongues of men and angels and have not charity, I become a sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and knowledge and have not faith, and have all faith, I can remove mountains and have not charity, I am nothing. Verse 3. And though I bestow all my goods and feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned and have not charity, it profiteth me nothing. In other words, if I give everything to the poor and I still do not have love or charity, it's meaningless. It's empty. We're talking about food stamps here, and we're talking about accountability. I did hear a reference to Matthew chapter 25.
Yep.
That shall the king say unto him on my right hand, blessed are you of my father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you. For I was in hunger, and you gave me meat. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. Naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came unto me. Then shall the righteous answer and said, Lord, when saw we be hungry or thirsty and gave you drink? And he said, we've done it unto thee, the least of my brethren. You've done it unto me. SB7 is not here. There's a personal responsibility. And he said, when you didn't do it unto the least of my brethren, you've done it not unto me. Now, people don't like to hear this. They don't like to hear the rest of the story. Then shall I answer them, saying, inasmuch as you did it not unto the least of these, you did it not unto me, and these shall go into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into life eternal. I just hear people quoting the Bible, and I just want to set the record straight that there is a context. There is a provision for the poor. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 10. If a man does not work, he should not eat. There is a moral imperative from what we call holy. If you do not count the Bible as holy or as your moral imperative, then you have a moral imperative from someplace else. But if you're going to quote the scripture, if you're going to say, I'm ashamed, or you should be ashamed,
then what you're saying is, I have to listen to your moral imperative. So if it's not the Bible, what is it? Is it what we teach our kids in school, natural selection, which just happened to come out of someplace in the sky, and we evolved into this being, and somehow there's a moral imperative? Where does this come from, this moral imperative? Who sets the standard? Now, to the bill. 1973, thank you, Senator, for bringing that up. I have no problem with helping those that are in most need. But in 1996, it was President Bill Clinton that helped with a bipartisan group on the other side in the House and Senate. Welfare reform. They set the stage at 130%. Was he wrong? Was he taking food out of people's mouths? Was he bad for doing that? By restoring it back to that level, is that somehow some evil thing? All right, here's a real important thing. I respect Senator Molly Kelly. She was a force to be reckoned with, Senator. She was a force to be reckoned with, and she brought up, the first time I ever heard of it, was this food insecurity. It is happening. Kids are going home without school. This program does not affect them. This bill does not affect them. We talked about the Catholic Charities giving £11 million in the state of New Hampshire to kids that need it. I'll tell you what's added to child insecurity, food insecurity. You want to hear it? $240 million in child support. If a man provides not for his own, the scripture says, because we love quoting the scripture, if a man provides not for his own, he is worse than an infidel. How dare you have a child and provide not for that child and put that responsibility on the taxpayers, on the people on fixed incomes? Shame on us! There are people that are on fixed incomes that do pay taxes. I can't stand holier than thou, and that's why I'm kind of animated here. Because I do care for the poor. I work with the poor. I walk around the track with a mother who's raised a teenage daughter who has not received child support. This lady can negotiate anything. What happened? Well, he just doesn't pay, and I gave up trying. Food insecurity? Let's get these people back in responsibility to paying their child support. Personal, right here at home, my daughter, my oldest daughter, is owed $22,000 in child support. Food insecurity? Is that this bill's fault? Is that the state's fault? Well, actually, they dropped the ball in enforcing some of these rules. So let's get these people who have children paying their responsibility. Get them to pay for what they are responsible for. The work requirement, 50 and under. My gosh, 50 and under, able to work, not disabled, not suffering from mental illness or opioid. If people are able to work, do you think New Hampshire wants to hear that they're not going to be required to work? I can submit to you that the people that I talk to don't want to just give to people that are refused to work. 1 Thessalonians 3:10, if a man decides not to work, he should not eat. There's the moral imperative. If you want to quote the scripture, if you want to try to shame us, there are horror stories everywhere. I lived it. We've been down this road again, like deja vu all over again. I lived in the poverty. I was in the orphanage. I hung with the kids. I understand poverty. I also saw the abuse. I interviewed people on my TV show, Dead Short, wrote a book, ripping the face off of welfare fraud. There's just a level of accountability. And we're not done when this bill passes. We want to provide for moms or dads that have children but can't get to work because they don't have the ability. That's coming. That's coming. Or if they need education, that's coming. I care. And I thank you, Senator, for bringing in this amendment. And I thank you for your support. I want just to make sure that this works for everybody. Thank you, Mr. President.